Today, the reality of bank deposit bail-in. Hello again, it's Martin North from Digital Finance Analytics. Welcome to the latest post covering finance and problem news with a distinctively Australian and New Zealand flavour. And today I want to discuss bank deposit bail-ins. This is a subject that is very concerning to many people, judging by the number of questions that I've received recently. And I find it very interesting that people in New Zealand seem to be unaware of what is in place there, thanks to the Reserve Bank of New Zealand's initiatives, which were put in place some time ago. And what I want to do is to talk about deposit bail-in in more detail today and use the New Zealand scenario as a way of illustrating the key points. So to start the story, let's look at the Open Banking Resolution, which is something found on the Reserve Bank of New Zealand website. And it essentially highlights the journey that would be taken if a bank failed. And the cartoon actually tells the story quite well. So there are two paths. The first path is a liquidation path, and there customers will be locked out without access to the money for a long time. And if you're lucky, maybe you'll get money back down the track. Or there's what's called the Open Banking Resolution. And this is the framework which essentially is deposit bail-in. And so the steps are, firstly, that the bank closes temporarily in the case of a crisis. The bank then reopens under statutory management, and customers will be able to access a portion of their money. The customers then will have some ability to use that money to pay their bills, but the rest of the funds will be used to recapitalize the bank and essentially lead to a restructured bank later. And possibly you will get your money back, possibly you won't, possibly you'll end up with equity in the bank. And it's the deposit funds held at the banks which allows this to happen. And the reason why this is so critical is that in the past, when banks have collapsed, they've been bailed out by taxpayers. And the problem with that is that it's very costly. Certainly in the UK or in Ireland, it had a big impact on the broader economy. And so the key point here is that rather than taxpayers taking the risks, in the Open Banking Resolution scenario, it's bank customers who take the risk, particularly those with deposits. And that may be more palatable for the government, who doesn't have to spend money, or indeed the rest of taxpayers. But the question is, what is the impact on those depositors? Now, behind this is a fundamental point that we need to make, and that is that bank deposits are actually unsecured loans that you've made to a bank. The old theory that when you hand money to a bank, that bank basically keeps your money and returns it when asked, is too simplistic. When you hand money across, you are making an unsecured loan to the bank, and that deposit or loan essentially is at risk, and it would stack behind secured creditors in the case of a bank collapsing. So deposits are actually more risky than you may first think. Now, this leads directly to the second question, which is, if you are a depositor in New Zealand, how do you know whether any specific bank is more or less risky when it comes to holding deposits? Well, the Reserve Bank has also helped there too, because they have published what's called the Bank Financial Strength Dashboard. And this is a pretty remarkable set of information, which helps people in New Zealand to pick over the various banks and to make some decisions as to how risky they are. And I want to go into some detail with regard to the Financial Strength Dashboard. And the first thing to say is that there is a relatively short list of banks in New Zealand that it covers, but for those banks, there is a considerable amount of information available. Now, if we start at the top of the page, we can see there we've got issuer credit ratings. Now, they say that a credit rating is an evaluation by a financial service company, a ratings agency, about a bank's ability to repay its debts. Moving from left to right on this rating scale indicates an increase in the risk of default. The distinction between investment grade and non-investment grade ranges is a well-recognized but somewhat arbitrary benchmark, and ratings agencies may use different labels and scales to describe their ratings. But they do have information from Moody's, and you can see there that most of the main banks are listed under A1, although there are some unrated banks as well. Fitch has a slightly different rating scale, with Kiwi Bank leading the way at AA, ANZ, ASB, BNZ and Westpac AA-, and then TSB, Co-op, Heartland and SBS below that. And it's worth saying that this is as at the 30th of June 2019. These scorecards are updated every quarter. And then you can look at S&P Global, and there ANZ, ASB, BNZ and Westpac are all rated AA-, whereas BOC, CCB, ICBC, Kiwi Bank and Rabobank are rated A, and some of the others are unrated. So you can get a relative sense of the risk from a credit ratings perspective. Of course, around the time of the global financial crisis, it's worth saying, the credit ratings got it horribly wrong, so the question is, in a crisis, how robust are these ratings? Now, the next section of the dashboard looks at capital adequacy and asset quality. Firstly, capital adequacy covers capital, which is a form of funding that can help absorb large and unexpected losses if they exceed profits. The Reserve Bank requires banks to hold a minimum amount of capital, and these minimums are set relative to the riskiness of a bank's assets. This regulatory concept of capital is related but not the same as the accounting concept of equity that is found on the balance sheet. Standardized and internal ratings-based banks use different approaches to calculate their capital requirements. And you can see there that the total capital ratio varies across the different banks, with some holding considerably higher ratios than others. Westpac, for example, is at 16.7, compared with BNZ at 13.7, and Kiwi Bank at 14.5. That's the percentage. And you can also see the total capital ratio regulatory minimum is set at 8%. So at the moment, all of the banks are capitalized above the minimum, but some more so than others. Now, also on this page is asset quality. And asset quality covers non-performing loans, or NPLs, and they are loans where a bank is likely to incur some losses. The NPL ratio measures the value of NPLs compared to the value of total loans. A lower NPL ratio typically indicates that a bank has less risky loans on its books. A high NPL can indicate that a bank is more willing to lend to riskier borrowers. And NPL ratios are also affected by the general state of the economy. And you can see there that some banks have quite a high proportion of non-performing loans. Rabobank, for example, at 3%, BNZ at 0.6%, and ANZ at 0.4%. Compare that with Kiwi Bank at 0.1% or TSB at 0.2%. So that tells you something about the types of loans that they've written and the underwriting standards that they've applied. Now, the next section of the financial strength dashboard covers profitability and the balance sheet. Firstly, profitability looks at the return on assets, the ROA, which measures a bank's profitability in relation to its total assets. This is a measure which is commonly used to indicate how efficiently a bank uses its assets to make profits. Any realized profits belong to bank shareholders, but profits also provide a buffer against losses before capital is affected. The ROA is shown as an annualized figure. So here you can see that the return on assets is highest at Heartland at 2%. But then ANZ, BNZ, ASB are around 1.2%, Westpac at 1%, and Kiwi Bank and Co-op considerably lower. Now, that is partly also a reflection, though, of business mix and size. And then also on this page, we have the balance sheet. And the balance sheet provides a snapshot of a bank's financial status at a point in time. Assets form one side of the balance sheet and are always equal to the other side of the balance sheet, which is comprised of liabilities plus the owner's stake. Assets are the economic resources that a bank controls. This includes tangible assets like cash and loans, but can also include intangible assets like goodwill and trademarks. For most banks, loans to customers are the most common type of assets on their balance sheet. And this particular view shows the relative size of assets held. So we can see that ANZ leads the way, followed by BNZ, ASB and Westpac, and Kiwi Bank somewhat lower, and then a tail of much smaller lenders below that. And then the next area to look at is the liquidity and credit concentration. Liquidity is all about banks and how they finance their operations with funding from shareholders and investors, including depositors. The Reserve Bank requires a bank to get a minimum amount of funding from stable sources called core funding. And the minimum amount of core funding is currently set at 75% of a bank's total loans. And banks must maintain their core funding ratio above 75% on a daily basis. This measure of the core funding ratio is averaged over the quarter. And so you can see there that some banks like TSB are well over. In fact, all the banks are above the 75% minimum, but some are higher than others. And in fact, Westpac comes in at 81.2, so is the lowest relative to the peers. And then we come to credit concentration, and credit concentration is a measurement of how diversified a bank's lending is across individual borrowers. A low concentration number indicates that lending is more diversified and therefore less risky. Lending concentration is measured against capital because capital indicates a bank's ability to absorb large and unexpected losses. So on this chart, the lower, the better. And we can see there that, well, ICBC is way out in front, but companies like ANZ and Westpac are also more exposed in terms of the credit concentration relative to, say, Kiwi Bank at 11, ASB at 16, or Heartland at 23.3. Now, so far, all I've done is just touched the high-level information. But if you want to get more, you can do, because you can drill down. For example, if we take capital adequacy, you can actually view more data. And then, as well as the capital ratios and buffers, you can also look at the capital breakdown to see the spread between the net CET1 and additional Tier 1 and Tier 2 instruments, and also the risk-weighted assets, which shows the split between the various dimensions of risk and how capital is allocated back to it. Now, I don't have time today to go into the other dimensions that are held in that dashboard, but it's worth having a look because there is some quite interesting information as you drill into each section. And it's also worth saying that there is a quite neat little facility on the site, which means that you can also get more information about any particular dimension that you might want to. So my point is that in New Zealand, there is quite a lot of information that the Reserve Bank over there has put up. And why have they done that? They've done it to try and help inform savers and those using the banks, and to help underscore the fact that not all banks are the same. And yet what's interesting is that many people in New Zealand are, one, not aware of the bail-in arrangements that we discussed earlier on, and two, are not aware that banks have different performance profiles and therefore risk profiles. So I think there is a massive job of work to be done in New Zealand to help people understand more about what's going on here. But remember this, deposits are unsecured loans. Deposits may be bailed in when a bank gets into difficulty, and therefore those deposits might be converted into capital or might disappear altogether. Or you might get some back, who knows. So don't think of bank deposits as 100% safe. And just before I finish, then let's come back to Australia, because in Australia, there is no such clarity with regard to the bail-in arrangements. There was legislation passed a couple of years ago, and that essentially gives APRA some wriggle room with regard to bail-in of deposits. If you pick up the term any other instrument from the legislation and apply it to deposits. But then APRA denies that deposits would ever be bailed in Australia, despite the situation in New Zealand, and despite what the IMF and other international bodies have said, and despite the fact that in other countries around the world, deposit bail-in is now part of the furniture. The other point to make is that in Australia, there is nothing like the level of disclosure that we saw on the dashboard from New Zealand. It's extremely hard to get good information about individual banks. And you can look at individual banks' balance sheets, but then they report on a different basis. There is no simple analogue to the New Zealand Bank Financial Strength Dashboard. And worse still, in Australia, APRA is restricted as to the amount of information about individual lenders that it can distribute, despite the fact that it may have more information at its fingertips. It's not publicly available. There is very limited information, and that's a major problem. So the takeaway today is, if you're in New Zealand, it would pay you to understand about the open banking resolution and have a look at that dashboard and get up to speed with the dynamics of the banks there. In Australia, we need to drive hard to get deposits clearly identified as either in the target zone for bail-in or excluded. At the moment, it's extremely fuzzy. And that is something which will take time and effort to do, but it is really important. But again, remember this, deposits are unsecured loans to the bank. And in that light, receiving almost no interest on deposits, or worse still, going into negative interest rates and having to pay to keep money in the bank, if rates do go negative, is put in a whole new light. And once again, it underscores how stupid the whole concept of negative interest rates for deposits is. I'm Martin North from Digital Finance Analytics. Many thanks for watching, and I'll see you again next time.